So my name is Alex Louise, and like Katie said, I was a pot washer. I left school at 15. I hated school. I don't like teachers. I still don't like school. I love teachers when they're doing their thing, but I don't like all the bureaucracy of school is what the problem is. Anyway, that's an aside. We have like 35 minutes. I spend hours and days with people normally. A client works with me for a minimum of 4 hours just to get started. So I'm going to get through as much as I can. Please feel free to ask questions. I'm interested in a conversation, not me talking at you for 2 hours. I would like to get to know who's in the audience first, because I could, you know, we could talk all day, right, about property and money and stuff. I'm aware, and I feel very honoured and privileged that I'm stood in front of the Yes Group. Like, I get you guys are all on a massive journey, right? You do a lot of personal development, you read a lot of books, you've probably done a lot of courses. You might even have done more courses than me. I doubt it. It would be big if you have, but, I'm willing to get that there are people in the room who are, like, already huge, massive people, so that's who I see you as. So the questions I've got initially for you guys are, who has been in personal development for a year? Put your hand up. So it's probably everyone, like everyone must have done a year's worth, because I'm going to go up in years, and then I want you to put your hands down. Okay, so everyone who's done at least a year, put your hand up. So everyone who's done like 3 years in Yes Group and personal development, so like 5 years, 7 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 plus years. I get the idea of who's in the room now, thank you, and I really, like, really thank you for listening to me. So from a property and finance point of view, how many people in here own one property? Again, just so everyone knows who's in the room. And two properties, three properties. So actually, let's do it. If you own one or more, like, again, everyone put your hands up and then put your hands down as it's not you anymore. So one property, two properties, three properties, 4, 5, 10. Okay, cool, great. So there's not as many people in property as I thought there would be in this room tonight. That's super cool. Okay, and who in here is a coach? Where are you? I know there's going to be lots of you. Amazing, thank you. And who here has a coach, more importantly? We're in personal development. I would like to think that you'd all put your hands up right now, like really. Even if it, yeah, cool. Okay, so that's who's in the room. So who I am, we could, again, you could all talk all day about who you are and I could, but I'm gonna keep it really simple and concise. Who I am for the world is wealth for everybody. In that context, that encompasses an end to homelessness, and that's who I am and what I'm about. I could talk all day about how we're going to make that happen. I actually don't know that yet. But it's just so you understand who I am and where I'm coming from. I believe that the more people that get financially free, the bigger the games they can play and the more stuff they can be up to in the world. My game is to get as many of you and the world out there financially free. Because if you're financially free, you get to go and do whatever it is really matters to you, rather than just be in a job that you don't really like, that doesn't really... I don't mean this in a derogatory way to the jobs that you're in. They're small games. You guys are in the top 1% of the whole world. Do you get that? You're like in the top 1%. The fact that you're in this room, you're in like the top 1% of the 1%. Because you're aware and conscious and you know what's available and you're already doing personal development. So I'm going to be really straight with you tonight and I'm going to speak to you as those big people. And I'm not going to deal with kind of moany complaints. Because we have no right in this room for moany complaints. We just don't. Any of you that have done any kind of traveling or spoken to someone that's homeless out there, you'll get some perspective. And if you're in a place where you're like, my life sucks, get that your life sucks, but you're still in the like 0.01% of the whole world. In the year 2017, where this mobile phone, like the world is in this mobile phone right now. And really what's available to us, especially in rooms like this, is that we can do anything, and I mean anything, if we so choose to put our minds to it. And that's the game that I'm playing. I'm not interested in just getting rich for the sake of getting rich. I'm not interested in getting property just for the sake of accumulating wealth. I'm interested in being wealthy so I can make a difference to the rest of the world. And that's who I am. And that's who I show up as a coach. And nobody has any leeway from that. Yes, we've got to deal with ourselves on the way to that. I have to deal with myself every day when I get up and I think, do you know what? I love my Springer Spaniel and I just could just go walking in the countryside and I've got a flat that's paid off and I never have to work another day again. And I could just be in my garden and walk my dog and pretend that the rest of the world doesn't exist. and it's a small game, and it's a waste of a life. And that's who I am for you guys. And there are days when I just don't want to do it. And there are days when I don't want to go to the gym. But I have an empowering context, yeah? So I'll offer you something from Lizzie's talk. My empowering context for my health and well-being is that I'm going to die at 125 in a snowboarding accident. That's my why. That's why I do gymnastics. It's why I do snowboarding. It's why I do HIIT training. It's why I do military class. Awesome. The why is everything, right? So I'm 37, but I'm not going to die till I'm 125. So all of a sudden, time as well. Anyone here? I haven't got enough time. Poof, time's suddenly gone like that. Roger, 65. Not even middle age yet. Awesome. So that's who I am. How I do that is I do money boot camps and ultimately joint venture masterminds, which is just my biggest baby and dream and love. And I put people together to joint venture together to get up to bigger things. And I would love to just say, we just do property and strategy and it's really easy and you just follow these steps. We don't do that. We deal with ourselves and we get out of our own way and we're up to bigger things. And we happen to get financially free along the way. And that's the way that, again, I do money. I don't mess around with, oh, do this strategy. This is what I did. It would be so easy to stand here now and say, this is what I did. This is the strategy. You guys can just go and follow that and then you'll all be free too. It would be easy for Lizzie to stand up here and go, this is my diet. Just go and do that and you'll all be fit and healthy. It's bullshit. It doesn't work. And it's the same with money. Just like you've dealt with every person that said about a different diet, it's different for everyone, right? And it's the same with money. There's no one way to make money. Every single strategy works, and it's the last missing piece in your strategy. You've got to know who yourselves are first. That's it. If I left you with one thing, it's an inside-out job. How many people have heard that? It's an inside-out job. How many people know that? And how many people are actually doing it? So when I say I'm going to be straight with you guys, you're in personal development, you're in the Yes Group, you know a lot of stuff. There's probably loads of things I could say tonight, and you'd be like, yeah, I know. Like this. Oh, she's telling me that I need a big why. Oh, I've heard it before. Yeah, you've heard it before, and if you're not doing it and you're not being it, you need to hear it again. And the reason I kind of shout is to kind of wake everyone up, because otherwise it's boring. Because actually every speaker and every person that has the privilege to stand up here and speak to you guys, we've all got the same message. You guys have all got the same message. The thing that makes the difference is being it. Not knowing it. Yeah? It's the same for your clients, as you know. Everyone knows how to lose weight, eat less, exercise more. How many people do it? That's why we have jobs, right? So, anyone who's here to hear my strategy on how to get rich, I'm not sorry. I want to say I'm sorry to disappoint you, but I'm really not, because it just doesn't work. If you want a strategy, go and buy a book. Read Robert Kiyosaki, Rich Dad, Poor Dad. Follow what he says, get it done. Easy, right? So why isn't everyone here financially free? It doesn't work. The bit that works is you know yourself and you deal with yourself and you have a coach or coaches, I have several, and you do the work. And do you know the power? The magic is in the breakdown. Everyone goes, oh, I don't want a midlife crisis. I don't want a breakdown. I love breakdowns. Do you know why? Every time I have a breakdown where I'm like crying and dribbling in the corner, I'm like, I'm on the verge of a massive breakdown right now. And then there's a breakthrough, and then I move on, and then I make more money, and I have better relationships, and I see my family more, and everything works better. Who here likes avoiding breakdowns? Be honest. No one likes breakdowns. Top tip of the night, start loving breakdowns. They're like where the magic is. That person that pisses you off, they are gold if you choose it. That person that really gets under your skin, you want to do some work? Deal with why they get under your skin. They're just a mirror. How many people have heard that, you know, all projection stuff? We all know it. And then we meet someone that pisses off, like, I'm not speaking to them again. No, speak to them. Find out what's going on. If you do that stuff, the money's the easy bit. It would be so easy. I have some clients. I get clients sometimes and I'm like, oh my God, they're so easy. They've got like hundreds of thousands of savings or they've got an inheritance. They've already got a couple of properties. They're earning 80 grand. I go, oh, this one's going to be the easy one. And then they sit in front of me. Who does the life coach wheel of life? You know that wheel of life? I hardly ever use it except for these clients. Because I just know that the finance money side is like off the scale. It's not even in the circle. It's like, and then I go, what about friends and family? And they're like, I go, have you got a partner? How's your relationship with your mum and dad? Oh, don't go there. So the circle's like, and then, and then I go, oh, I thought this one was going to be easy, but we've got to deal with all that because actually the money's the easy bit, right? And that's it. I know that's it's it and it's everything, right? It's huge. But that's what works. Being wealthy and being happy are two completely distinct things. Does everyone, like, you know that, you know it, but you don't really know it? Because everyone still thinks, when I buy this car, when I buy this house, when I get this job, when I retire, then I'll be happy. You're all going, oh, we know this. I know you know it, but be it. Like, really? How many of you actually know what your financial freedom figure is? Got to talk a bit about money, right? How many? Like, hands up high, I can't see you. Cool. I'm going to be really straight with you. You guys are in personal development. Managing money is like everything. If you don't manage your money right, you know, you can pick an area, you can pick health, you can pick any, but you manage your money right. Who thinks that, who doesn't know what financial freedom figure means? And be honest, there's nothing like, so you don't know what it means, right? So financial freedom figure is literally the bare minimum that you can survive on. Because people do this thing with goal setting. They watch The Secret and then they go, oh, I want a mansion and a thing in the Bahamas and I want all this stuff. And they forget, actually, there's a lot of mechanics involved. And one of the best places to start is, what's your bare minimum expenses that you survive on? Mine's about 800 quid a month. People, and I say that, people are like, what? Like, literally, my flat's paid off, the business pays the bills, and I probably need 800 quid. So my expenses are paid by the business. I need 800 quid, and I could probably live on 500. And when I say expenses, I mean, like, basic food, healthy and nutritional, not, like, braces, bread, and ready meals. So, like, there's a level at which you need to spend a bit of money on food. You need shelter, and you need clothing. And I'm not talking about an Armani suit and a Rolex watch. I'm talking like the basics. Do you know the easiest way to get financially free is you work out that figure and then you go to work on replacing that with income. But if you don't even know your figure, so this leads me on to the main thing, the first thing that I do with all my clients is, where are you at? Because if you don't even know where you're at, the rest of this conversation is pointless. It's just completely pointless. Because if you come to me and you go, I need £1,000 a month to live, I go, great. Let's go to work. And then we can figure out stuff to get you £1,000 a month, which, by the way, you can do in one deal. Like, it's so easy. It's the funniest bit is the bit that actually to get free is so easy, like beyond ridiculously easy. But we get so caught up on all of this stuff, like all of the stuff, like it's too hard. The property market's going to crash. Someone said to me in the break, what about Bitcoin? Like, we get into all of that. We come to all of these talks where everyone stood up here, unfortunately selling a strategy, and then you go every month, it's perfect, like property investors network meetings are hilarious, every month there's someone standing up there going, this is the only way to do it, it's the best way, and every month everyone like sways to the next idea, never actually doing anything. Whereas if they knew what their financial freedom figure was, found someone who'd done it before, got a coach who stuck them to one thing, and worked out how and what works for them. Yeah, I'll give you an example. I've got a client who is an optician. He moves around a lot because he's really good at upscaling his income. And to do that, he needs to move to get big pay rises. I'm talking like 10, 20, 30,000 pounds at a time. He's very office-based. He's an optician, he's not hands-on, right? So I'm an ex-chef. I'll fill a skip any day of the week. I'll smash up a kitchen tomorrow. So I like doing big refurbs, but if I told my client to do big refurbs, he'd be like, that's weird, don't like it. Yeah, but he earns good money and he's got his cash flow right and he can afford to buy properties. So he buys 4-bed new build houses up in Merthyr Tydfil. Everyone's writing that down. I'm like, oh, that's got to be a good one. It only works for him because he knows what he wants to do. Yeah? So it's like he knows who he is. We find the strategy that fits. The strategy is the last piece of the puzzle. It's the easy bit. I've got another client who absolutely detests old houses, can't stand them. So again, new builds. But then I've got other clients, meet myself included. I have one new build. I only did it because it made so much money in auction. Like it was 40,000 and it needed 10 spending on it, valued up at 100. It was worth getting over myself and my new build phobia to make 50 grand. But generally I love old houses. So I buy old houses that are wrecks, but I love it and it works. And it works for me, but it wouldn't work for everyone. So again, you get your financial freedom figure, but then you've got to figure out what you love. I don't know where you live. I've had clients coming from Bristol, funnily enough, saying they'd seen other speakers speak saying that they should buy in the valleys. And I'm like, why? You live in Bristol and you have a big house. So she had a big house that she didn't want to live in. In one conversation, she realized that the house she was living in that she didn't even like because it was with her ex-husband and it was all that, all the memories and the kids are old now and they've gone and all of that. She could just turn that one house that she already owned into an HMO, go and rent a really cute little apartment that she loved. She was financially free. But she was coming to me saying, I need to do refurbs in the valleys. I'm like, why? Like, it just doesn't work. Out, inside out, outside in. You see the difference? Outside in, she's coming to me, I've got to buy in the valleys. 2-hour session, turned a house into an HMO, job done. What's next?
HMO?
House of multiple occupancy. So a shared house. Yeah? So lots of people living in one house. So I have an HMO. I have an 8-bed HMO with 4 bathrooms and 2 big lounges. And everyone was like, why are you buying? Don't do HMOs in Pontypridd. Yeah? So here's another thing. Markets are hilarious. Everyone goes, oh, what about the UK property market, Alex? What about it? There's no such thing. There's a, this UK property market that everyone talks about, it means nothing to me. What means something to me is what's the market like in Pontypridd in the town centre, in Treforest where the students are, on that specific street. There are streets where I buy and streets where I wouldn't. There's a street market. There's a house market in that one street. Talk to me about that, I'm interested. But housing market? Who here's got a fear of property crashing? Cool. It doesn't, like, the best example I can give you of a property crash when everyone goes, oh, house price, so the newspaper, how many people here read media, watch the media in this room? I'm hoping it's not many of you. Don't do that. Just don't do that. So the mainstream media goes, house prices crashed by 25%. And everyone goes, ah! But the media doesn't say, off the back of a 300% increase over the last 7 years. So that 25% is next to nothing. It's not even real. It's just a headline. So again, it's about knowing our stuff and knowing our area. And yes, London goes up like mad, and the valleys where I invest doesn't. But do you know what the valleys does? It cash flows every single day. It just does. I bought a house 4 years ago for £19,000. 2-bed house. Most people don't even realise that's possible. They think I'm nuts, especially when I speak a lot in London. Can you imagine me saying that to people who live in London? They hate me. They hate me. And then I do an exercise with them, which is work out how much money they waste. So here, and so this is the Yes Group. So we could do this really quickly, right? You could do this when you go home. So this is not on my list. I'm getting sidetracked, but it's really important. So you could do a list of all the things you waste money on, right? Because people say to me, oh, I can't save. Let's have a look. Yeah? You do this in London. I don't know about Bristol. So everyone's got their thing, right? The Starbucks coffee on the way to work, the glass of wine on the way home from work, the prep lunch because they don't want to prep their own lunch. I'm guessing that in this room it's quite high level, that there's not a lot of that going on, but I don't know. If you have a look, there are people in London who spend... They buy Starbucks on the way to work. They buy a Pret at lunchtime. They get an Uber taxi to and from work because they don't want to walk and like the tube is just not them. And then they rent apartments for like £2,000 a week. And then they go, oh, I haven't got any money. Yeah, no, I know you haven't. But like you could have. So again, it's about choice. Like really, it's about choice. You know, do you really, like it's the same with food. Do you really need that? Do you really want to eat that chocolate bar? Do you really want to spend that money? Or are you just spending it to feel good? It's all choice, especially when you've been in this room with me. because now I've said it and you've heard it, so now you've got no excuse. Like, every time you go to pay for something now that's £5 or less, I want you to hear my voice going, really? 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 Do you really need that? Do you really want that? Are you really going to enjoy that Starbucks coffee so much that you're going to be grateful that you spent that money? Or are you just doing it because that's what you do and you're so asleep that you're not even aware where you're spending your money? Because that's it. I've got like, I spent £10. I'm so proud of my thermos. I hang out with builders a lot. And we have a thing with it, builders like have, you know, you have vans and you want your coffee. So I make coffee at home and I put it in, and there's all these cups have come out in the last couple of years with all technology. It doesn't spill anywhere. That's like, do you ever have that problem? You don't take one with you, do you? No. So anyway, it's a thing for me. So I spent £10 on a thermos and then I just take coffee with me. It's only a tiny thing, but you add that up. So do this at home. Like when you go home tonight, don't just add it up for a year. Add it up for 10 years. And then tell me if you really want that coffee. The next thing that quite often comes, people go, oh, but that's so boring, so frugal. All right, save all the money and then spend half of it on afternoon tea in the Ritz and save the other half. But for the love of God, do something interesting with it. Like, really? Afternoon tea in the Ritz with someone you haven't seen for a long time, with half a year's worth of Starbucks coffee money, or whatever it is for you, versus Starbucks on the way to work, not even aware of it. By the way, we're wrecking the planet by throwing the cup away. I'm not even going to go there. I have one person on my advanced joint venture mastermind who she's like, she's all over plastic. I hate it. So people come to me for the workshops, and I feed them because I'm an ex-chef, so I'm still a chef, really. And she's like all over plastic. So she makes her own yogurt now so that she doesn't have to like buy the plastic things, and she doesn't like aluminium foil, so she comes, I'm like, oh my God, there's plastic everywhere. But that's her thing. But really, think about it. Think about a straw. One straw every time you have that kind of drink, or one cup every day. So if you don't want to save your own wallet, save the planet. Just stop doing it. Oh, this is my favorite. Whose life are you living? Oh, we're in personal development, aren't we? We've all heard this one before. But really, whose life are you living? Who's on your shoulder going, shouldn't do that, can't do that, not good enough for that? Whatever else it is, should have gone to school. Yeah? My dad, when I said I wasn't going to do uni, and then I said I'm not doing A-levels, oh my God, you'll never amount to anything, Alex. Okay. But really, who's running it? Who's running the show? Even now, whatever age you are, who's running it? Find out and deal with it. As soon as we get to, I'd even say 16, I'm going to give everyone a break and say 18. Once 18, it's our responsibility. You know, it's just our responsibility. And we just live our lives looking good and worrying about what other people think. And, oh, I can't. I drive a black Ford Transit van. I could get into a whole world of like, oh, what will people think? I drive a van. Getting rid of it now because I don't use it anymore because I'm kind of done with that bit of my property stuff. But how many of you are driving a car because of like what other people think? Or buy, like, how many of you lease a car that's way more expensive than you can afford just to look good, to keep up with everyone else's cars in the office car park? You know? I'm guessing in this room, like, not so many, but, you know, it still goes on. Because everyone, even in this room, there'll be some kind of looking good. Which, and it might even be the opposite. Be like, no, I don't buy Starbucks. I get wheatgrass. Same thing, guys, sorry. Or, no, I don't buy McDonald's. I get, I don't know, whatever. Bristol's got loads of, like, healthy fast food places. So you eat that and you're like, no, I don't buy McDonald's. It's the same thing, right? Yes. Has anyone got any questions right now? Can I carry on ranting? Cool. We've covered so much already. You guys are quiet. Where do we want to go next? So,
do you think properties for everyone?
Say again?
Do you think properties for everyone?
Ooh, now there's a big question. I love questions. This is my, I like it when I shut up because then we get the juicy bit. So here's a better question, or I'll reverse it back to you. It's irrelevant what is for everyone. It doesn't work and it doesn't matter. My question is for you is what is good for you? Because where your brain is going is like, ooh, is property good for everyone? Who gives a shit? Like, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if it's good for the guys next to you and not for you. What do you want? Do you see what our brains do? We're like, oh, is property the thing to do? Oh, what's the property market going to do? Like, great question. By the way, any of you that ask questions, totally doing the work for the rest of the room, they were all thinking it, but they didn't have the guts to ask it. Because they were like, oh my God, what's she going to say? She's going to like totally jump all over me. But really, what are you into? Why did you ask that question?
Because I guess like when there's property stuff, there's loads of people that go into it and want to do it, but really it's like with anything, it's not really for everyone. And I mean, obviously that's my belief, but it's not relevant. It's actually what's right for me.
So what is right for you?
I think property is right for me.
Great. Sorry everyone else. Don't give a shit about them. It doesn't matter. It's like, what do you want to do, right? Because that's it. If property's right for you, great. But then again, what property? Because what people do, and it's why you hear all these property horror stories, is everyone think they should do property. They go into property, they follow a strategy of someone stood up on a stage saying, do this, it works. And then they go, oh, it didn't work for me. Yeah, vegan diet doesn't work for me, so I don't do it. Yeah? What do you do for a living? Can I pick on you? So by the way, anyone who doesn't want to answer my questions, you can just say, like, leave me alone. I get it. It's cool.
I'm a pharmacist.
Cool.
But I've got properties on the site to help me as well.
You've already got property?
Yes.
And he's asking me if property's right for everyone. Do your properties work for you?
They work for me, yeah.
Great. And they bring in money?
They do, yeah.
And what do your family say about it?
They think I'm doing well.
Great. Why the question?
Because you said ask a question.
Cool. Amazing. Boom. And what I'll say back to you is, and all of you, is the quality of your life. How many have heard this? I'm sure this is a Tony Robbins thing. The quality of your life is reflected in the quality of your questions. So I invite you to ask a higher level question. It's a good game, right?
What is your... like equity then in your property portfolio? Because normally when I meet people, the first thing they ask you is how many properties you've got, and I think that's...
it's irrelevant, right? Yeah.
And so I normally sort of say, well, actually, you can have one property in London and it's worth 5 million. You can
I'm going to sit down and let him do the rest. He like totally knows this stuff.
So the question is, like, whenever I meet people or whenever I'm trying to learn from people, I'm trying to find out, like, what have they done and sort of, like, what's their sort of... equity,
I got it.
All the properties they have, are they sort of mortgage-free properties, and are they sort of still sort of like on 80%?
I got it. And I could answer the question. It would be boring and irrelevant. So I'm happy to answer it, but it's still not a high-level question. So I invite you again, ask a better question, because you're still asking about me and what I do, and it's irrelevant to you and what you do, because I have a relatively high debt strategy. Okay. If any of you want to. I'm not going to answer the question tonight. Read Unfair Advantage by Robert Kiyosaki. It'll tell you everything you need to know about why I have a high debt leverage at the moment. It's about 75% to answer your question of debt. Okay? Actually, it's less than that, but I'll refinance that.
How do I clear $900,000 worth of mortgage debt?
Now we're getting there. Now we're getting there. Why do you want to clear £900,000 worth of mortgage debt?
That's what I've got. Outstanding in my mortgages.
Great. Why do you want to clear it?
Because I want to be debt-free.
Why? But, like, this is it, guys. This is coaching, right? Do you get that? I could answer your question, and it would just be BS. I'd be doing you a disservice. I can't charge money for that. I could charge money for what I'm doing now, though. Do you get that?
Yeah.
So why do you want to be debt-free? By the way, anyone who's like, do this version of it for yourselves.
I guess it's just my blueprint. It's just the way my mind works.
Take Lizzie's coaching. What's your why? If there's no why, don't go there.
Yeah.
So I guess most people want to be debt-free.
Why?
So that all the money they earn is theirs. And they don't have to come and spend it out. All the money that comes in is theirs.
It's to have more time to do what I want to do.
But why do you think that you can't do what you want to do without with debt? I do what I want to do every day of the week. I've got loads of debt, like millions.
No, I can, but there's limitations.
Why? What will paying off 900,000 do for you? How much? So I'll ask a better question. And you can decline to share figures, but it's helpful. Mm-hmm. Okay? And you can either share actual figures or you can share sort of percentages, right? Like, I didn't share with you how much equity I've got, but you know that I'm leveraged 75%. Do you see that? So how much income would you gain if you paid off the 900,000? And so you don't have to answer this in front of me, but the question that I ask you is, how much more income would you get? Because if I paid off my, like, whatever it is now, it changes all the time because of deals I'm doing, but let's say 1.5-2 million moves up and down. If I paid all that off, it's not worth it. Because if I put that 1.5 million into something else, I'd have like way more than the income that just paying that debt off would be. It's just my strategy, by the way, as well, everyone. If you want to pay off your debt, like, please do, but understand why you're doing it. And really, like, be able to get why you're doing it.
Because ultimately, you don't really want to pay off our debts.
Why?
You live in a mortgage-free flat.
Why? Well, I do, but I'm just mortgaging it to pay the tax man to put everything into a limited company. But yes, at the moment, I, in theory, do.
But again, and then obviously, as you sort of develop and stuff like that, or as you get richer, you don't want to have debt. You want to get rid of the debt. So
like just use I instead of you, because I don't mind having debt. Yeah, so, it's part of my strategy.
Okay. So I guess my question is, I mean, for me particularly, which is why I'm here, is like, how do I sort of either develop more,
yeah,
get more properties.
Yeah, good question.
Find a way to just basically clear all the mortgages and stay where I am.
Great. The answer is you find your why. Your coaching was brilliant earlier. It's the same for money and fitness, just so you all know. You find your why. There's no why there at the moment. My why do I do gymnastics and go snowboarding and do what I do is because I'm going to die at 125 in a snowboarding accident. What's your why for property? What do you want? Where are you going? Why are you doing it? Yeah? I have no interest in paying off my debt. So we could talk content all night, but it's kind of irrelevant because once you get the context of where you're going, like, I want to end homelessness. I have no idea how I'm going to do it. I'm going to enroll lots of people to help me with it, but I don't know how I'm going to do it. I'm not caught up in the content. Because if I thought, how am I going to do it? I would never start that project. I am insane, like insane. And I could find lots of people who would agree with me that I'm insane. And we'd all like, we could all go to the pub and be like, yeah, homelessness is just something that's there, right? We could drink our wine and whatever. The context gives you the content. Your why, to give it another word, or your dream or whatever it is you choose to call it, gives you the answers of what to do next. And that's where you go to work. And this is the bit that everybody misses when they're doing money. There's no context. It's just, I want to earn money. I want to be financially free. Why? What are you up to? What gets you out of bed in the morning? Because for me, I've got houses now, right? I don't need any more houses. So it doesn't get me out. I'm literally bored of buying houses. I can't tell you I'm so bored of buying houses. But if I buy houses, that means I can do bigger projects to do with homelessness. I'm in. I'm like out of bed in the morning. You ask the question, who jumps out of bed in the morning? I do. Because I know when I walk my dog every day and I see Steve, the homeless guy, who I chat to on a regular basis, who's helping me with a project, that's my why. Because once you become financially free, actually, I'll hold my hands up. I've spent this year has just been like skyrocket. The last four before that, I was bored. All my friends were still working. I was like, what do I do now? Boring. I needed some time off and all of that. And I needed to figure out what it is I wanted to do. And I did some projects with cooking and chefing to see if there was anything left there to do. There isn't. And now I've got my why, and now I'm again. What matters to you?
My wife and my daughter, I guess.
Cool, what else?
I guess myself first.
Sure, what else?
Making a contribution to other people.
Great, how? What matter? What? Okay. Here's a. So anyone who doesn't know like how to find out what matters them, what pisses you off? Because do you know what? Homeless people piss me off because I feel like a failure. Because if I'm a landlord and I believe in providing good housing for everybody, and there are people that are homeless, I failed in my chosen career, right? Child abuse pisses me off. Yeah. Children not having decent homes pisses me off. Where do I go to work? I go there. What pisses you off? Great. What does that mean? Do you see how big that people wasting their lives? What does it mean?
I guess people with opportunities not taking the most of
it. Yeah, like everyone in this room right now. Everyone. And me. I have days when I don't do what I could do. Yeah? What else? What matters to you? If you could, like, wave a magic wand and just get rid of something, a problem in the world, what would it be? Haven't you? The quality of your life is given by the quality of your questions. If you could wave a magic wand and get rid of a problem in this world, what would it be? Someone said Donald Trump. We could... No, we can't go there. Say again?
Get rid of laziness.
So get rid of it in your own life then. And then what else would you get rid of?
Greed.
Procrastination.
What does that mean? So there's a Donald Trump greed thing going on here, right? So we're going to go there. We just are. So I want to share something to you about this situation. So it's really easy for us to stand here and blame Donald Trump, because he's really annoying, right? The problem is that we as a society create Donald Trumps every single day when we write people off and when we have a go at them. And when actually we say Donald Trump is a problem, we're just the same as Donald Trump. Because you know what Donald Trump does, which is what upsets us so much? He goes, I don't watch the news. I really don't. It's eliminated from my life. From what I get from bits and pieces, he doesn't like Mexicans and he doesn't like certain groups of people. But then we actually, do you know what scares me more than Donald Trump? Are the people that don't like Donald Trump and hate on him. And I know that's like confronting, but we're just the same as him then. And it's how wars start. Because we don't like Donald Trump, so we hate on him. And we're doing exactly the same as what he's doing to other people. Sure. But do you know what? The problem is that what we then do is we go, we don't like what he represents, but he's saying the same as us. We're actually all the same and connected. This is so, like, it's why I said, oh, I don't know if we've got time to go here. It's such a massive conversation for me at the moment. It's in the same room and the same world of the coaches out there doing the narcissist codependent work. It labels people, it writes them off. It makes one bad, one good. It makes one wrong, one right. It makes one a victim, one a persecutor. And it doesn't work, and it's how wars start.
Yeah.
It just doesn't work. You know, I used to have it that, like, I'm a codependent and I'm in narcissistic relationships. No power, no room to breathe. He's wrong, I'm right, dead, everybody. Wars start. Doesn't work. Because actually, if we take that as an example, codependents are manipulative narcissists, and narcissists are just overtly, they say what they want. Everyone's in the same space. And actually what there is to get is to start speaking to people and say, what are you dealing with? And start caring, because all we do is we just write that group of people off. We write Donald Trump and his supporters off as bad and wrong, and we cover them in shame. Like, right now what's going on with the guy, I don't even know his name, again, I don't watch the news, but this whole Hollywood thing that's unspinning with the guy to do with sexual abuse, it's horrible. What he did is horrible and it doesn't work. What's more horrible now is the hate and the shame that is put on him and people who have done things that don't work. Because it just makes the world horrible. And it's how wars start. It polarizes, exactly, and then we dehumanize everyone, and then there's no one's got any air to breathe, because we're just like, well, we're right, and then everyone else is like, well, we're right, and then we've got war. So what there is in eliminating that and greed, is to actually go to these people and say, what are you dealing with? Like, what is it? What's happened? I had an ex who was really racist. And I didn't actually, when I found out that he was, it took me some time, because I used to have it that I didn't have a say. So I didn't ask people, I wasn't straight with people. Which some people find weird, because my dad's like, really? You've never had a problem saying stuff to me. Some relationships I had a problem being direct. And I said, why? And he said, well, my daughter was raped by a black guy. And then he just wrote off. Yeah? But when I got his world and we had a conversation, actually, he's not racist at all. But I got his world, rather than just going, you're racist, that's wrong, get away from me. Does that land? Cool. So if you want to go to work on Donald Trump, go to work on getting connected with people you don't like. Get their world and have conversation. There's an amazing video actually on Facebook between white supremacists and another group. I think that Black Lives Matter group, where they're all in a rally and they actually all end up talking. It's an amazing, amazing video. And it shows what's possible. Getting hot in here. You all thought we were going to talk about property and we're like saving the world. Who else has got a question right now? By the way, you're doing it for the room if you ask a question. Yeah.
Just about to take out half a million from the house to put into property.
Cool.
But
yes.
Loads of voices saying you miss it. It's about to, you know, Bristol.
Yeah. Yeah. So can I clarify? Who are the voices? Are they financially free from property? So get rid of the ones that aren't. Maybe have a conversation with the ones that are. But I'd really get clear about what they mean by that, because they're just saying, "Oh, Bristol." They're saying what? Sorry, Bristol's. Like, it's just, it goes like that, right? Like, it peaked in 60, 70, 80, 90, 2000. It doesn't mean anything. That's like a perfect example of, like, when we just talk general, it doesn't mean anything. Like, what's peaked? So what am I supposed to do? Go, oh, I'm not going to invest in property because, like, you used to be able to buy a house in Merthyr Tydfil for £2,000 when I was 16 and now they're 50 grand? Oh, it's gone.
No limit to how property's going, in your opinion, is it? Is it
just continuing? Crystal time. It's bullshit. Do you know, I love it when people say that. They say, oh, the kids can't buy. And actually, so, awesome project, because there are areas where people can't buy. But there's also an inability to see that if they just moved a bit, like I did, when I bought my first house and moved to Tonrevel, and everyone went, what are you going to the valleys for? Like, kids, that whole conversation where we go, oh, kids can't get on the property ladder, it's so disempowering, because it's not true.
But it's often they can't where they've got their work, because going to the valleys, they can't often get.
But it's not, but, so people in London, this is, and thank you for saying it, because it's perfect, because we all have our version of this. People say that. But actually, they could live in the valleys and commute, because there are people in London. Has anyone ever lived and commuted in London? And how long did you commute for? An hour and a half each way every day. And then people go, oh, but where I live, where my job is. People live in London, they do an hour and a half, two. There are people that live in Cardiff and commute to London, Bristol and commute to London. There are people that live in Wales and commute to Bristol and vice versa. And we disempower young people and we disempower ourselves when we go, oh, poor you, you can't afford to get on the property ladder. No, move, find an area where it works and get it done. You know, it's so privileged in this country, so privileged. And then we go, oh, poor kids, they can't get on the property ladder. It's a lie, it drives me nuts. I was talking in a school in Newport the other day to a load of 16-year-olds. I do a role models program and I go in and take over a class. So they can see what's possible, because I left school at 15. And they go, oh, but Newport's shit, it's so deprived. I'm like, oh. Just like, well, make it not deprived then. Actually, that was what I said to them. I was like, well, go and make it not deprived, you know? And they were like, oh, but you know, there's no jobs here. Well, go and make a business then. Go and make jobs. You've got a mobile phone. You're the most privileged people in the whole world, and you're moaning that there's like no jobs and that it's deprived. And it, like, really, we just need to get off it. We're so privileged, we don't even know it. Like, we really don't. I get it too sometimes. Do you know, it's so funny, and I caught myself doing it. I was in All Saints, it's a really expensive clothes shop buying clothes. I was complaining that this year's winter wool wasn't thick enough and I wasn't gonna buy any more clothes there. Like, I was really on it. Like, oh my God. I caught myself halfway through and I just went, do you know what, stop, I'm really sorry. Like, let's just move on. Because it just, really? The thickness of the wool this year in All Saints? Fuck. My God. Oh. But like, really, look in your own lives. Where do you do that? Because actually, we all do it, but it's the awareness that changes it. It's the, oh my God, I can't believe I just said that. Okay, sorry. Does that make sense? Does that answer your question? And your money?
Well, I don't know, I've got £1,700.
Great, give me a ring.
I will, actually.
I'm like so cheap, you wouldn't believe it compared to that amount of money. Do you know how much money I make people? Like, seriously, I'm not even shy about it. I'm so flipping cheap. I charge like 250 quid an hour, and I'm so cheap for the money that I make people. I had a client call me today, 2-minute conversation, didn't realize you can get cash drawdown on a credit card, was struggling to like finish a deal to buy it out cash. I was like, just get another 10 grand on a credit card that you can draw down in cash. He was like, what? I was like, yeah. He was like, really? I was like, yeah. He phoned me back 10 minutes later. Virgin just gave me 10 grand in his bank account at 1.9% for 36 months. 2-minute conversation. Saved the guy thousands in interest, made the deal happen, and then he'll go on to do other stuff. So I make no bones about what I charge and that it's flipping cheap for what people achieve. Most people get my fee back just in rejigging insurance and like using the right thing. Like, it's just like the money that people make once I coach them is ridiculous. And it's an investment in yourself. It's an investment in all of you. How many of you, you have a coach and you're like, oh, I spend all this money on this coach. You're not spending it on the coach. You're spending it on you so you get to grow. I've spent tens of thousands on coaching. It's worth every penny. I've got coaches who charge me thousands and I'm like, wow, she could have charged me 3 times that and I'd have still thanked her. Because the value it gives and gets. Get the help, get the professional help. Pick someone you get on with. If you like think, oh, I don't want to work with you, you're really annoying, like find someone that does. But like really, you know, we have these like big sums of money and then we go, oh, I'll speak to my friends down the pub. And they're like, oh, that's really scary. And they have all their money. So we all have money stuff, right? Anyone done like minute, what is it? The T. Harv Eker stuff. You can deal with all your money stuff. Great weekend. Highly recommend it to anyone. Yeah, it's good, right? It's really good because you like deal with all your money stuff. So everyone's walking around with all this money stuff. And then we're all asking each other for advice on money. Don't do it. Don't do it. Because all you're going to get is their money stuff. I say to Michael, they say, oh, what do I say to the solicitors or the broker or the, like, you tell them what to do. Because if you get, do you know, my broker is brilliant. My broker, Matt, I love him dearly. He did my first mortgage. He's been telling me for 13 years not to buy property, to rent it out. And I'm like, yeah, great, I got it, Matt. Can you just get me a mortgage for this one? He's like, oh, but there are only 4 mortgages available, Alex. You know, you could do another deal where there are thousands of mortgages. I'm like, yeah, great, I only need 1 mortgage. Can you get me the mortgage? I get that you care about me and I get this isn't your strategy, but just get me, he's a really good mortgage broker, but he doesn't get out of his own way. God help a client that went to him to say, should I invest in property? He'd be like, no, don't do it. Him and his wife do flips. In the crash, who got wiped out? Not me. You've got to know what you want and you've got to have someone that's with you and then you go and tell the world what it is you want and you get it done. Don't go to the world saying, what should I do? Because you'll get everyone's opinions.
Don't.
Cool, good.
Generally, when it comes to property,
yes.
I guess there's multiple strategies.
Yep.
Generally speaking, it's better to buy property to rent out or get property to
who knows what I'm going to say right now? I don't know. What do you want? It like, what do you want? Great. How much?
Lots.
How much is lots?
I haven't considered property, so I don't have any figures in my mind for this.
Great.
I'm thinking about what strategy tends to work best, or is it just kind of
different? Right. Yeah. Just rewind a minute. I'm just going to rewind. We're going to go back to the beginning of the evening where I didn't say, listen to the person at the front of the room and take the coaching. Right. Now we're going to go to here. We're going to go back. The coaching was, strategy is the last piece of the jigsaw. It's fairly irrelevant. Figure out what you want, and then the rest is easy. Right? So the question you're asking me is still in the content without the context. Yeah? How much do you want? How much is your financial freedom figure? What's your why? What are you up to? Where are you going in the world? Then it'll answer the question. And it might be both. It might be neither. I don't know you. I've got clients who don't invest in property because it doesn't work for them. They'd be terrible as landlords. I have a question on my questionnaire. What do you think about tenants? It's brilliant. I shouldn't tell you this now because you all know it. Oh, some of the stuff that people put about tenants. Do you know my tenants? They pay me like on average $5,000 a year. They're like really good clients. I don't know how many of you have got businesses that pay you, you've got clients that regularly pay you $5,000 a year, every year, regardless, and you just gave them one thing once and then they keep paying you. But people who don't like tenants, they've got a lot of stuff to get over before they can actually have tenants. Does that answer? I know it doesn't answer, but yeah. So I'm aware it's 9:45. I could go all night. But I don't know what we're like. I don't know where you're at time wise. One more. Like, okay, so I'm going to request one good, big, ass, juicy question.
Well, are you dealing with people who are clients? One of them is money, but they have a really big, fat, sensitive archetype.
What does that mean?
They really want to sort
Can we do two questions?
No.
Is that you?
Yeah.
Cool. I don't know. Come work with me. We'll find out, right? Like, that's it. So I have some. So I'm relentless with my clients. I have joint venture mastermind groups, and they invest in, they do a company together and they invest together. And the way that I have them have each other and the way that I talk to them is like this. We're climbing Everest together. And if someone's got altitude sickness, you don't leave them behind to die. We stay at that level until their altitude sickness is dealt with, and then we all move ahead as a group. And that's who I am for people, whether it's one-on-one or group coaching. Personally, I prefer groups now. It's more powerful. Works quicker. It's cheaper for everyone. That's who I am for people. I have clients who I'm relentless with. I have clients who, I would say if you're one of those clients, you make me grow more than anyone else. You make me work harder, faster. You make me figure stuff out more. You're my favorite clients. Pain in the ass, but you're my favorite clients, right? Yeah, that's it. There's no, we write people off in this world. We give up on people. We go, oh, you're too difficult. You've given up on yourself because you have it that you're, what was it you called yourself?
Saboteur.
Yeah, you call yourself a saboteur. You're there before you even start because you have it that you're a saboteur. I would say you're not a saboteur.
No, I'm not. I'm a fighter, but I'm
getting
my own way
along. Great.
I'm not with me today because I realized that I have quite a lot of shame about some debt.
Yes. I love it when I help people. It's cool. And like, have a clarity session. I'll see if I can help you. By the way, I only work with a few people. Like, there's not enough time in the day. I have a property business that I run. I'm doing flips myself and still doing stuff with family members. And I have joint venture mastermind groups that I work, like, I work this hard for them when I work with them. So there's limited, but I also have resources of other coaches and books and really quickly. And then we've got to go.
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, someone who knows that next to fuck all about property.
But you're aware of that. Yeah. Do you know that's way better than someone who thinks they know everything? So, so much better.
Yeah, so I've got, around the chair, guys, Robert Kiyosaki, Grant Cardone, one of those people.
Yeah, I love Grant Cardone.
So, we've got 2 years to talk about a destination, keep that family home. So, I'm thinking, do I get one property just with one big deposit and take most of the capital off? Or do I save one?
What's your why? Coaching's like really hard and really simple. You just have to like stick to the thing of what it is you do. Yeah. What did you do for a job?
I'm a magician.
Cool. So you do what you love, right?
Yeah.
Like, do you do, like, he's a magician, everyone's like, oh.
Basically, I just want to do that, but I don't want to do that as much. I just want to travel as well, so.
Cool. Maybe. That's a bit missing in your thing. You could travel a lot and work and earn a shitload of money and become financially free if you set your mind to it and you ask yourself a better question. Like, you could be the traveling magician that vlogs and has people show up and does really cool stuff. You want to speak to this guy at the back, Ben Lowry, he's really good at stuff like that. Like, really, play a bigger game, have a bigger context, and then it'll answer the question, and by all means, give me a ring. Because, again, I can't coach, like, that specific question.
Yes.
Cool. Thank you, everybody, for your time and attention.